So, I want to say welcome to everybody who's watching live. Welcome also to anybody who might watch later on YouTube. I'm going to run a modern league with Bridgevine Hogaak. Let's see what this puppy can do. So yeah, for those asking, I'm playing in the Team Modern Super League tonight, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. That's going to be on the main twitch.tv/magic channel. And you can also, they do a pretty good job uploading those VODs right away. So if you're going to be asleep or at work or whatever, for can't watch for any reason, you can watch the following day the recordings. Okay, so sometimes when you play a deck like this for the first time, it takes a minute to process exactly what's going on with your opening hand. My instinct is this hand looks fine, right? Because I can use Stitcher's Supplier plus Carrion Feeder to mill myself for 6. And I don't have a way to discard the Vengevine, but I could also start dredging Dark Blast, and pretty quickly I can just hard cast Hogaak. So this hand definitely does something. I don't know if it's the best possible hand. Jarvis in the chat says this hand is great, so sounds good to me. I'm playing behind a mulligan to 6, by the way. Okay, turn 1, Dryad Arbor. So, what are we thinking? Boggles or something along those lines? Excuse me, something along those lines. Well, I don't think I can resist just Dark Blasting that Dryad Arbor. And I guess this is probably the type of deck where you want to use your fetch land sooner rather than later. Both for delve and for deck thinning. And for not milling the swamp that I want to search for later. Okay, so we'll go ahead and dredge the Dark Blast. This is a nice little warm-up game where my opponent seems to just have a really poor draw and I can sort of just goldfish to learn my deck. Gravecrawler, I'll be able to cast this from my graveyard if I have either Stitcher's Supplier or Carrion Feeder in play. Seems like I'm definitely starting with Stitcher's Supplier. And now my second creature that I cast will wind up returning Vengevine to the battlefield. It seems like I roughly break even whether I cast Carrion Feeder or Stitcher's Supplier. I'm going to choose to cast Stitcher's Supplier because then I can use those two to delve and convoke Hogaak. Okay, didn't hit Bridge from Below or anything like that. So, here we go. 2 mana from the Convoke. And then I guess I can just exile. Makes sense to exile Altar of Dementia. Good habit to get into for opposing Tarmogoyfs. And then I'll attack. So that's pretty cool. I kill my opponent's creature on turn 1, and then I put 14 power on the battlefield on turn 2. Good showing, I'd say. And now, if I'm reading my opponent for Boggles, I guess I'm bringing in these Wisp Mares as an out to Rest in Peace. Also just generally good against Boggles. Does not seem as though I need Leyline of the Void or Ingot Chewer until further notice. Lightning Axe could be okay against the Core Spirit Dancers if they have it. Don't think I want Thoughtseize, but any of these creature removal spells would be fine options. Let's take a look and see what I can cut. Often sideboarding with these decks is very challenging. All you can really do is trim one card here and there. Dark Blast wound up being really strong in that first game because it so happened my opponent had a Dryad Arbor-centric hand, but that's not going to be the case all the time if it's indeed Boggles. So I could see boarding out Dark Blast. Jarvis in the chat suggests boarding out 2 Alter and 2 Bloodghast. Could definitely see Bloodghast being slow and ineffective in this type of matchup. Okay, I've definitely on board with boarding out 2 Bloodghasts for starters. Canister cuts Vengevines and Bloodghasts. Okay, well, we have a couple of votes for boarding out Bloodghast. This makes a lot of sense to me. My instinct is to take out Dark Blast against a deck that doesn't have, like, Noble Hierarch or Thalia or whatever. It's true that my opponent could be on Infect. That's a great point made by Watchout in the chat, so maybe I should be a little careful taking out the Dark Blasts. And either way, I'm inclined towards bringing in these 3 creature removal spells. Can trim a Vengevine, trim an Alter. All right, I'll give this a try. Vengevine definitely doesn't seem bad, especially bringing in Wispmare. That's another 1 mana creature to help get it into play quickly. Well, we have a lot of people sort of just talking about how dominant this Hogaak deck is. I'm not sure how dominant it is. I can tell you that we have it in our lineup tonight for the Team Modern Super League, but I can tell you that both teams are submitting 5 decks, so if you want to watch some Modern featuring a diversity of matchups, you know, that you're going to see Hogaak tonight, but you're not going to be watching it all night if you tune into that. Now, this hand's a bit awkward. I like that I have Wispmare and white mana. I like that I have Fatal Push. And I like that I have Insolent Neonate. But I do not have red mana to cast the Neonate. And even if I find red mana, I don't really have an engine. So my inclination is to send this one back. Okay, and now this hand does not have Wispmare, but it's just a really good sort of engine hand where I can cast Faithless Looting and dig to what I need, discard Vengevines, maybe discard Dark Blast if I want to get the dredge going. This is a keep for sure. And then I'm going to go ahead and discard this since I already have my creature removal locked up in Dark Blast and Lightning Axe. I really just need either a Wispmare to protect myself from the scariest cards or just more action, more graveyard action. Okay, so it's looking like it's Infect rather than Boggles. Certainly a tougher matchup since the clock is so fast with Infect. And I'm thinking I go for Blood Crypt and Dark Blast. Okay, missed land drop from my opponent. Dark Blast looking just stellar. I was able to dredge a Hogaak and a Gravecrawler. So I could just Dark Blast here, or I could get a little greedy and try to Faithless Looting into a land. I'm thinking I just Dark Blast. I mean, how can you really go wrong? Bubble asks, why didn't we see you at the Mythic Championship? Oh, I was there, but I did not have a... I won the first round, but I did not have a good record for very long. They didn't let me anywhere near the feature match area. Okay, so I'm just going to take my draw here. Actually, it's an interesting question. I suppose I should... I guess it doesn't really matter. I'm going to be drawing Dark Blast with one of my three draws this turn, so I'll just take my draw step, and then I will... Faithless Looting and probably Dredge Dark Blast on the final dredge. Okay, so I'll take my first draw step, then I'll dredge the Dark Blast. So relevant cards in my graveyard: Hogaak, Gravecrawler, Vengevine. I'll be discarding Bridge from Below and Vengevine, I suppose. And I'll pass. Okay, so now the Neonate can allow me to generate a zombie from Bridge from Below, and then that zombie can allow me to cast Gravecrawler, which can allow me to get Vengevines back, and then we're really in business from there. Okay, my opponent has seen enough. So that was definitely a good showing. I did not have to face any graveyard hate that game, but a good illustration of what this deck can do, I suppose. Certainly the hero of that match. Lutang Clan asks, is it irrational to main deck 2-3 surgical extractions in Jeskai control? I think that if your deck has a bunch of Snapcaster Mages, it is reasonable to main deck surgical extraction. I generally like surgical extraction alongside Snapcaster Mage and don't like it really in other decks. Alright, so I'm on the draw again, and this hand, yeah, just looks fine. The Stitcher Supplier Carrion Feeder 1-2 punch gives me a nice way to get the ball rolling, and then if I'm able to assemble the combination of Altar of Dementia plus Hogaak, then I'll be in great shape. Hey, Kodrek, thank you for the sub. Shivan Reef indicates to me probably Storm combo, which could be a tough matchup. Alright, so let's go for a Blood Crypt and then play Stitcher's Supplier. And I milled a Dark Blast and a Faithless Looting. Since my hand kind of has everything I need, it seems good to just dredge Dark Blast. And I milled a Gravecrawler, still no Bridge from Below. So that Goblin Electromancer is pretty scary. It could represent a possible win for my opponent next turn if they have the right cards. So what can I do? I could start with Carrion Feeder and sacrifice Stitcher's Supplier. I can go Carrion Feeder, play Hogaak, then sacrifice Stitcher's Supplier, and then if I'm able to find a Bridge from Below, is that good for me? Alright, I guess Carrion Feeder, sack the supplier is how it's gonna start. And I hit another Gravecrawler, still no Bridge from Below, which means I do not think I'm going to win this turn. So perhaps the best I can do is cast a Gravecrawler and then play Hogaak and just have some power and toughness. Lefinzer, thank you for the sub. One, two, three, four, five. All right, do your worst, my friend. Yeah, I mean, I think this game is over next turn in one direction or the other. I think basically my opponent needs the turn 3 kill off this Electromancer, or else I'm just going to win with the Altar of Dementia shenanigans. I don't think I'm really that concerned with killing the Electromancer next turn. Okay, well, my opponent deep in the tank, as they should be. Just weighing all the possibilities. Can I go for it? So Altar of Dementia is a card originally printed in Tempest, reprinted in Modern Horizons. It says, sacrifice a creature. Target player puts a number of cards equal to sacrifice creature power from the top of their library into their graveyard. So this is an engine card where I can repeatedly mill myself, sacrificing my Hogaaks and, you know, Bloodghasts, Gravecrawlers, whatever it might be. And then it also serves as an alternative win condition if my opponent has something like Ensnaring Bridge or anything that's going to stop me from winning with damage. Alright, so both times my opponent has cast Serum Visions, both cards went to the bottom. Alright, Steam Vents tapped. So if my opponent does not have Remand, should be a pretty easy win for me. If my opponent does have Remand, then what can I do? I think I just take my draw step. All right. So if I play Insolent Neonate and my opponent does not remand it, then I get to use that to discard Bridge from Below, which just at face value will make my Carrion Feeder large enough that it requires the Goblin Electromancer to chump block. So that seems good because I think my opponent, if they couldn't kill me last turn, is also going to be very unlikely to kill me next turn if they start the turn without Goblin Electromancer. And it's slightly better if my opponent does have Remand to start with the Insolent Neonate rather than just playing Alter as the only spell I get to cast this turn. And note that because my opponent has double Shivan Reef, it actually does matter quite a lot if I can just reduce their life total to like 3. You know, that's... That cuts the number of colored spells that they can cast in a turn. Okay, so now if I play the Altar, it gets remanded. Opponent's at 15. Then I swing for 12, effectively 13 because of the zombie. Alternatively, I can just play some Gravecrawlers and make this a lethal attack. So I guess the question is, how important is it to win versus just killing the Electromancer? Do I want to play around Remand? Do do I want to play around a bounce spell? And actually, let's rethink this. If I attack and my opponent does not block, sack zombie, sack Gravecrawler, sack zombie. Okay, so it doesn't even net me any damage. I think I'm just going to present a lethal attack and not play into a possible remand here. Opponent's not blocking, so therefore representing a bounce spell, but let's make them have it. That doesn't seem like it's going to do it. All right. Now, not sure if I would need to expect Leyline of the Void out of Storm combo. I think I clearly want Thoughtseize and the cards that kill creatures. And then Leyline would not be unreasonable, but I'm not feeling like I necessarily need it. Out come Dark Blasts. One Altar, two Bloodghast, one Vengevine, something along those lines. I'm not going to cut the mismatching altar, because if I draw one altar and it's the old bordered Tempest one, it's going to make me really happy. So I'd rather just have the one nice one in my deck. You know, I was trading for these altars this morning, and this one is worth like 28 tickets, and this one is worth like 4 tickets. Go figure that one out. I am not playing in Dallas this weekend. I'm actually doing commentary, but I will be there. Hey, coffee mugs, thank you. Thank you for the cheer. All right. So I guess I'll grab my basic swamp and play Stitcher's Supplier. think that's right, yeah. For anyone asking about my Grixis deck from the last Mythic Championship, I think it's pretty likely I'll play some Standard with it tomorrow on the stream. So it'll be the same time slot, 11 a.m. Eastern Time. Okay, so opponent presenting a fast clock. And what can I do? What can I do? Faithless Looting seems like a strong draw. But note that I will not be able to return Vengevine to play. The best I can do, maybe... I mean, I can definitely set up for turn 3. I don't think there's really much I can do this turn, except maybe Faithless Looting into a Fatal Push or a Thoughtseize. Alright, feels like I'm dead. I've not played much with this deck list, it's only my second match. Alright, that might be beatable. Okay. So, I am going to need to win the game or produce 8 blockers. Gravecrawler can't block. So if I play Alter, I can mill myself for 8 and make 2 zombies, and if in those 8 cards I find a Hogaak, seems like my position's pretty good. So is that my best play? Just hope Hogaak's in my top 8 cards? Alternatively, Faithless Looting could help me find a land and get me a little bit deeper. I think Alter is probably my best move. Note that I can also use the zombies to mill myself further. Okay, I found a Vengevine and a Bridge, so we're setting up pretty well. another bridge. So now, just thinking about if I want to sack the zombie first, I think the answer is no. I think I just sacked the supplier. And I found Hogaak. So now, one, two, three, four, five. Now I'm just going to do that a bunch of times, and I can even start milling my opponent instead of myself. Vengevines come back as well. So opponent has 41 cards, I have 16 plus 20. So I'll pop my opponent's graveyard to make sure there's no crazy card that gets milled that might change this equation. Boy, this Altar of Dementia card is kind of powerful. And your turn, my friend. Sweet. ChannelFireball.com features the best players in the game writing about the best game in the world. You can find strategy content from dozens of different players about every format under the sun. I'd also like to say thanks to Ultimate Guard for supporting me and supporting the stream. You can get information about their products as well as a link to their website in the panels below my stream. Nicorobo asks, how am I liking the Katana sleeves compared to the old KMC sleeves? Well, I will say that for many years, I used the KMC matte sleeves. They were my favorite, and those are great sleeves. I have nothing bad to say about those, but the Katana sleeves are the best sleeves that I've ever used. And while I am sponsored by Ultimate Guard, I would not say that if I didn't believe it. All right, well, this hand, you know, it's not great. I wish I only had two lands instead of four, but I think I'm supposed to keep a hand with a Faithless Looting and some decent engine cards. Just hope, you know, the top top four cards in my library give me something to work with. Does Ultimate Guard hook me up with tons of product as part of the sponsorship? Yeah, they do. There was like a couple weeks ago where they sent me a huge box of just sleeves and playmats and binders. I showed it off a little bit on stream, but they're quite generous. All right. I think it's still good to cast Faithless Looting on turn one, because then I can maybe Vengevine on turn two. And I have been prioritizing thinning my deck. It seems kind of important in a graveyard-based strategy like this one. Ooh. So I guess we're going Vengevine Bloodghast or Bloodghast Bloodghast. I guess Vengevine Bloodghast, right? Who's doing commentary in Dallas? So it's going on the team. The only reason I'm hesitating is I might not be able to remember every single person on the team from memory, but the people that I know will be there are myself, William Jensen, Maria Bartholdi, Riley Knight, and then I think the fifth one is Marshall Sutcliffe, but there may be someone that I'm forgetting, and if that's the case, I apologize to them. But I do know it's a really, really good team. We're going to have some good... We're going to have a good weekend, a good broadcast for you. So I was able to find Gravecrawler, which means I can return the Vengevine, and it seems like maybe this is just going to be a beatdown game, unless I hit something kind of special with the Stitcher Supplier. And I didn't really hit anything, so then I'll just go with the Gravecrawler and beat down with a Vengevine. And at least I have a turn 4 kill with just attacking with creatures. Probably not good enough against Storm Combo, but, you know, at least it puts a little bit of the pressure to them. No land drop from the opponent, but Baral could easily represent a win next turn. It seems like the only play I can really make is to flashback the Faithless Looting. Alternatively, what, I just cast Hogaak, but that doesn't really accomplish much. Oh, okay. Yeah, I guess I should cast Hogaak. So I guess I overlooked the option of just casting Hogaak last turn via Convoke and Delve. If I had done that, I guess it really would have put a lot more pressure on my opponent, which would have been good. Suppose I'll sideboard the same way I did last time, which was to bring in three Thoughtseize and three removal spells, trim an altar, Avenge Vine, two Blood Ghasts and two Dark Blasts. Okay, good hand. We're going to start off with a Faithless Looting. Goodbye, Bridge from Below and Gravecrawler. So I only have one red mana unless I draw into a land off of Faithless Looting or Insolent Neonate. I think what I should do is play Stitcher's Supplier followed by Insolent Neonate. And the reason I do the Stitcher's Supplier first is I could find Vengevine or Bridge from Below. So I did find Vengevine. Now alternatively I could do Carrion Feeder and sacrifice Stitcher's Supplier. Sure, I guess that's better. Although if I'm planning on trying to win on turn 3, I don't really want to leave myself with all these uncastable red cards. So you could definitely make a case for playing Insolent Neonate this turn. I think I like the Carrion Feeder play. And I did find Hogaak as well. Let's go ahead and play that. Note that Hogaak is legendary, so there's no casting two here. Alright, that one was a little bit more smooth sailing. Gonna have to throw back this zero lander. And this one as well. Wish we had the London Mulligan here, but alas, we do not. Hey, Nicarobo, thank you for the sub. I will be in at Grand Prix Dallas. I'll be doing coverage. Man, where's my lands? Have to go to three cards before I find a land. I mean, should I just keep this one? No, I don't think so. Well, I don't think I'm winning this one. Lost Wald, thank you for the sub as well. Appreciate the support. Okay, I think that's enough for me to scoop this one. Probably should have won that match if I had played tighter in game one. It's true, I am learning. That's the goal of this league. Well, I guess this hand is, like, passable because of the turn 2 alter. Like, turn 3 at worst, hopefully I can mill a Faithless Looting. This is, like, not one of my better hands that I've had today, but I think I'm going to keep it. Bubbles, thanks for the sub. Hey, we got a raid from Yellow Hat. What's up, Nassif? Welcome to everybody who's coming from Yellow Hat's channel. We are going to be playing together, Yellow Hat and I, along with Logan Nettles, in the Team Modern Super League tonight. It's going to be a great show. I'm just trying to learn this Hogaak deck, which has been a little bit of a trial by fire. This is my first time playing with it. But, you know, my teammates are so good that my strategy is if I can show up tonight and just not horrifically embarrass myself, I think we're going to be fine. Playing against blue-white control, they're likely to have a counterspell. So I think I don't want to play the altar this turn. I think I want to just start with land Neonate. Maybe it gets countered, and then I play Carrion Feeder. End of turn, make a zombie. All right, we have Esper. Sure. Sure. I think I'm just going player here. Yes. Well, I milled a bridge and a vengevine. Those will be helpful if I can draw a non-land card at any point in this game. All right, little help here, little help. It's actually a pretty good draw. So my opponent could have Cryptic Command. Yes, it's true. I have only one fetchable land left in my deck, one Godless Shrine. Gravecrawler is pretty sweet as well. Yeah, my opponent is not necessarily going to die to creatures. They can have Supreme Verdict at instant speed from Teferi's ability. They can have Cryptic Command. I suspect Cryptic Command, which means I want to be careful that I can recast the Altar of Dementia if it gets bounced. Could also be Kaya's Guile. Alright, that's a third Bridge from Below. So now I'm just going to go to combat and make my opponent have something. And then I can still try to win via Altar of Dementia post-combat. So on the board, I have mill for 6, and then 17 zombies is 30. So I can mill for 40. I think I'm just going to start milling my opponent. So you can see 16 zombies represents mill for 32, plus I'm milling 4 here, and I can cast Gravecrawler from my graveyard 2 more times. So I can mill my opponent out, and it's hard to imagine what they can do to stop it with only 2 mana. I guess I also get to see a whole bunch of my opponent's deck. Nile Spellbomb main deck, good to know about. Sure. Kaya's Guile, so instant speed exile graveyard. Second, Nile Spellbomb. So pretty tricky to know how to sideboard because, I mean, I know my opponent has at least 2 Nile Spellbombs, but does that make Ingot Chewer worth it? It's not really a great answer. And then my opponent has white and black mana, so they could either easily have Leyline or Rest in Peace for the purposes of Wispmere, but then I know they have a healthy amount of non-enchantment-based Graveyard Hate also. So, where does that leave me? Clearly, Dark Blast is pretty weak, so that's an easy cut. Thoughtseize could be fine. Wispmere could be fine. I mean, I think this is the most basic level of sideboarding, but Thoughtseize and Wispmere are also totally good options. Kind of like the altars. Scully Face suggests trimming a Hogaak. Yeah, I think Bloodghast is annoying enough against these control decks that I'm going to leave them all. Good hand. Think I'm going to Thought Seize just because they could have Rest in Peace. Force of Negation. Exiling Esper Charm, you got it. Yeah, so I realized that I could have played the fetch land to play around Surgical Extraction, but I think this fetch land sort of needs to commit to going for a Godless Shrine, which would have not allowed me to cast Insolent Neonate. I think I'm going to attack, then I'm going to go Bloodghast, Carrion Feeder, Hogaak. Oh, I can't spend mana on Hogaak, right? So then, what's my move? Yeah, now should I put my opponent on having like a board sweeper where maybe I don't want to just use all my cards? I think I might actually just pass and play slow. This is not like my previous matchups against Storm where I need to try to clock as fast as possible. I need to more focus on presenting resilient threats. I guess I might as well start the turn with this. It will help me understand what to do. Pitched Esper Charm for the turn one force. I have one basic swamp that I previously discarded. Alright, can the top of your library defeat a 2-1 and a 1-3? That is the question. Sure. Yeah, I'm live. You're watching live. Hopefully, at some point, you'll be able to find the VODs on ChannelFireball.com or the Channel Fireball YouTube account. All right. Kaya's Guile the old-fashioned way. Yep. So I'm considering sacking the neonate. But I don't think I need to do that. We'll just wait as long as possible. You want me to sacrifice a creature and then exile all cards from my graveyard? Oh, I forgot I had another Godless Shrine in my deck. So what happens if I play Altar and evoke the Wisp Mare and sacrifice it? Not that good. Yeah, I thought I was out of white sources of mana. I would have just cast this last turn as a 1/3 beatdown creature. Bottom set says the top of my opponent's library was pretty friendly to them. I'm an underdog now. I don't agree. I'm still planning on winning this game. If they find like a planeswalker here, then you know, game's close. Sure, that doesn't do much. Well, I'll tell you this much, I may have lost this game if I didn't have Wispmare. I mean, I'm just winning with creature beatdown here. If I had had Assassin's Trophy, it does almost nothing. All right. So that puts me at 3-1. Actually, the only games that I've lost, one was where I just made a bad error against Storm. I didn't cast Hogaak on turn 2. And the other was when I mulliganed 3. So I would say pretty good showing from the deck so far. Player still needs a little bit of work. But we're learning. I believe someone can fact check me on this, but I think I lost all 5 die rolls in this league. Which, if you play 5 matches of Modern and you have a good record after losing all your die rolls, probably means your deck's pretty solid. I'm keeping this hand in honor of my mismatched Altar of Dementias, because I know that'll drive a couple people just crazy in the chat. So I think with this hand, I sort of just played a little slower, let things develop a little bit, and then I'm not going to sack the Neonate. I'm just going to cast Altar of Dementia on turn 2 and do nothing with it, and then hopefully after a couple more draw steps, I'll find something to do with the Altar on turn 3. Okay, Vengevine makes things interesting. I think I'm still sticking with the plan. I guess I can even block the Mariner and sacrifice to save myself 2 damage. Benekit, thank you for the sub. I'm going to play one of these mismatched Altars just so that I'm sure to keep 2 different arts of the card in my hand. I think that's the best value here. Tariq asks, why do I have the mismatched Altars? Well, we're not millionaires here. It cost over 100 tickets to get four of the nice version. Sure, that's not too scary. I was going to sack it anyway. I still need to find a little action, though. I need, like, one more good draw before I can get moving. Like, any non-land, non-alter of dementia card. Ah, man, come on. So what do I do? Do I even cast the Carrion Feeder? I mean, I guess I just cast another altar. Okay. Chat bringing up good points. We're looking for a non-land, non-Altar of Dementia, non-Bridge from Below card. And it's got to be now, because otherwise I'm just dead. Carrion Feeder can't even block. Alright, come on, anything. Alright, that's good. That's good. We can work with this. So, I start the turn by playing Neonate. And I'll discard my altar. I could also just not sack it. Yeah, this actually seems fine. Just give myself another turn. That's fine. Alright, I milled a second Vegvine, a Hogaak, and a Bridge from Below. That's a good start. So now let's take my draw step. I think I should win from this position. Crack Neonate.
Hogaak.
I'm actually going to sack my zombie token first. Maybe I made an error in not giving myself blood gas as an out, because I need to get a second untapped creature in order to cast Hogaak a second time. Oh yeah, I can sack the feeder. So we should be fine then. I can sack the feeder. Triple Vengevine. Alright, this seems good, and then just present lethal for next turn. Alright, so humans, I want all my creature removal. They usually don't have Leyline or Rest in Peace. They can have Grafdigger's Cage. But Grafdigger's Cage doesn't even really seem like it. I mean, it's good against me. It's not amazing. Channel Fireball is the best place to get singles, supplies, booster boxes, and more. You can use the code Reid, that's R-E-I-D, just like my name, at checkout to get a 5% discount when you shop at ChannelFireball.com. We'll be taking a mulligan here. I'd also like to mention that if you're going to sign up for a Grand Prix tournament, you can use that same code Reid, and that that's basically a way for you to support the stream. It's not going to give you a discount, but it will result in it's completely free to you to use that code, and it will result in a $5 donation from CFB events to my stream. So if you if you're here watching, you're enjoying the stream, it's completely optional, but if you're going to sign up for a Grand Prix, using that code Reid is much appreciated. Meanwhile, my opponent's down to 5. A Grand Prix is the main event at a Magic Fest event. They're big open tournaments, usually about 1,000 players. Highly recommend it. All right. Yep. Ooh, Oriok champion. Boy, a 2-2 Oriok champion is actually pretty annoying for me to beat. Ah, Graft Digger's Cage. Well, that looks like a 3-drop creature. But, I mean, what could it really be? Like, this seems... It seems hard for this block to go wrong for me. Oh, it's to remove Bridge from Below. I understand. Yeah, I forgot to do this last turn, but sack the token to the Carrion Feeder, of course, is the right play. I cannot flashback Faithless Looting because of Grafdigger's Cage. And the reason I played the land is if in case I want to Fatal Push a 3-drop creature. Sure. Hey, Cubed, thanks for the cheer. So I have one Ingot Chewer in my deck that can deal with this annoying Grafdigger's Cage. Alright, now I have an 8/8 trample. So I feel like my opponent is holding either a land or some kind of, I mean, probably either land or Reflector Mage. I guess I'll put them on land and just go ahead and start my turn by attacking. Feels like they should be dead if they just have land in hand. Deputy of Detention. So good thing I can Fatal Push that. So opponent needs Reflector Mage or Deputy of Detention. Actually, that's not true. Any answer to Hogaak in the form of a creature will allow them to gain life. But yeah, it seems like kind of Reflector Mage or bust. And bust has it. So I'm going to finish 4-1 in that league. Pretty good result. Reminder, we have Team Modern Super League tonight. My team is Pomplamoose, myself, Logan Nettles, Gabriel Nassif. It's going to be 9 p.m. Eastern time. Don't miss it if you like Modern. Sure. It is a bad time for European people, but our opponents are all Europeans, so if they're competing, what's your excuse for not watching? Of course, you can also just catch the replays, watch them later. Alright, round one infect yet again. Was I supposed to keep this hand or not? So, good draws are Stitcher, Carrion Feeder, Faithless Looting, Neonate. Anthony Leet, thanks for the sub. You have to kick the vines because the unkicked version only gives Shroud, and it's the kicker that gives +4/+4. All right. So, I think I attack first and then I start milling myself for a bunch. Yeah, that seems best. My goal for this turn is to produce a creature that can block. I found a bridge, which means I could find Hogaak and potentially win this game. Ooh, no, no, no. Oh, I sacked the wrong thing. Shouldn't really matter, but I did sack the wrong thing there. I think I'm in pretty good shape here. I'm going to get to see a lot of cards, and if I find Hogaak, I think I can win this turn. There's the Hogaak. There's our man. So against Infect, although it's white-green Infect, so you kind of have to expect any white opponent to have Rest in Peace. I really don't know about bans. I have not developed an opinion on that. I mean, I'm operating under the assumption there's going to not be any bans, but I guess it's definitely possible. This deck's really, really good. Well, this is sort of a reactive hand, not my favorite, but I'll keep it rather than go to five. And I guess Dark Blast is just so good against Infect. Take the rest in peace. I guess I'll upkeep Dark Blast, right? Don't really have any play this turn except just swing for one, play a land. Now, my opponent topped a card after the Mulligan Scry, and I have no idea what it could be. It's not a land, not a creature, not a Rest in Peace. Maybe another Path to Exile? Maybe another Pump Spell? Alright, go go Carrion Feeder. The only thing I could do is like Dark Blast my own creature, but that seems counterproductive. As long as my opponent's not doing anything, I'll just keep beating down for one and drawing cards. It is definitely possible my opponent is holding creatures, but just doesn't want to play the Dark Blast. Hypothetically, they would need like two creatures and a pump spell to get through the Dark Blast, because I can end of turn cast it and then dredge it and cast it again. Okay, that's something. Found a bridge. Remember, my opponent does have Path to Exile. And I found Faithless Looting. So I guess in response I want to sacrifice Gravecrawler and the feeder itself, make more tokens. We're not quite presenting lethal next turn, but pretty healthy army here. Okay, there's all the creatures. Wow, is this going to be a overload scale up move? Yeah, I guess I'm fine losing my bridges. My bridge. So, Hogaak is strong, but with no bridge and no altar, I think I'm just going to stick with my original plan of kill two more creatures and then force a chump block. Well, I could still cast Hogaak, but not if I want to force a jump block, because my opponent's at 11 and I have 12 points of attack. Rain Vorland asks, is it a bad idea to put Death Shadow and Dark Confidant in the same deck? I think so. And there's two reasons. Number one is Death Shadow and Street Wraith go together like peanut butter and jelly. And I think it's hard to play Dark Confidant and Street Wraith in the same deck. And then also Death Shadow is like you have to be pretty careful about managing your life total and planning out close race situations. So in some ways, even though controlled life loss is really good in Death Shadow, unpredictable life loss is like very, very bad, because if you were on to go down to, you know, three life with a Dark Confidant in play, like you can't really do that, at least not easily. So I generally try to not put those cards in the same deck. My opponent generously offered to tell me their archetypes since they know I'm playing Hogaak, but you know, the thing is, I'm just gonna make an 8-8 and try to win on turn 3. Doesn't really matter what I'm up against. It would be helpful, for example, to know what sideboard cards my opponent has, but the archetype in game 1, I think we're pretty much on the same plan no matter what. My Dredging Dark Blast, probably. I found Grave Crawler. Yeah, MTG Training Grounds making a good point that the fact that I have two alters actually makes it a good play to play alter if my opponent's holding a counterspell. It's like kind of annoying if it's remand, but if my opponent counters the first one, then I want to be able to go alter plus Gravecrawler next turn. Surgical extraction targeting grave crawler. I think I am A-okay with that. So there's a Venge Vine. Venge, that mill, that okay, that was a good mill. That mill was Hogaak double bridge from below. Not too shabby. Okay, we have Snapcaster Surgical coming for my either my bridges or my Hogaak. Coming for my bridges. Sure. Oh, yes. Killing a Snapcaster would save the bridges that are remaining in my library. So that would have been a great play. Instead, my thought process is I have Faithless Looting to try to find a second creature for the Venge Vine. And I hit. So even though I made an error a moment ago, it looks like I'm not going to be too punished as triple Vengevine with Alter to protect against a board sweeper should be good enough to beat blue-white control in game one. Alright, so we're thinking Wisp Mares and Thought Seizes. Out comes Dark Blast and Vengevine. Perhaps one Hogaak. Well, this hand looks strong again. Even have the answer to ley line all ready to go. Rest in peace, rather. I think I'm just going to Faithless Looting. My goal is to hit second land as quickly as possible. Alright, so ooh, I can cast Hogaak. Let's not make the same error that I've made previously. Alright, so now even if my opponent is Rest in Peace, it's kind of like Terminus or Bust. Sure. Purge and path. So we take the path. Am I just fighting through this stuff? Am I looting to try to find white mana? Sure. Ooh. That's ugly. Now I might lose. Guess I'm just on 1-1 beatdown again. Yeah, that's a really good play. Field of Ruin my white source. I kind of suspect my opponent has another timely reinforcements based on them not using their path to exile. I would think if they had nothing, they would just path right away to keep their life total high. Supreme Verdict. Oh, both my godless shrines are exiled. It's going to make it pretty hard for me to win. Well, a Ninja Turtle, I just beat Green White Infect 2-0 in the last round. Which is not to say that it's a good matchup or anything, but it's just funny. Alright. I think we're in desperation mode here. I like this hand. And my opponent beat me on mult to 5 last game, mult to 6 this time. Pretty clearly has high standards in terms of wanting a hate card in the opening hand. found Bloodghast and Bridge from... Or I discarded Bloodghast. I found Bridge from Below. Alright, you think you better have rest in peace here or you're in trouble. All right, so let's think here. If I play the altar, then I go fetch land, sack Bloodghast, sack fetch land, sack Bloodghast, cast Bloodghast, sack Bloodghast. So that's three triggers. If I play Bloodghast first, then I sack it to the feeder. Then I play fetch land, then I get two more counters on the feeder. Then I sack the fetch land, then I get two more counters on the feeder. Or, excuse me. I confused myself, but basically the question I think boils down to, do I want one more mill with the altar, or do I want one more sacrifice of the Bloodghast to get a counter and a zombie? I think the answer is I want one more sacrifice of Bloodghast to get counter and zombie. I feel like I have a good chance of winning here. Basically, just need to find Hogaak. Now, if I start sacking zombies, that's basically going to mean I have four more mills to find a Hogaak. Or I could attack and then just have a two-turn clock. I guess I won't risk it. Opponent pretty much needs like rest in peace here and then either timely reinforcements or a wrath on turn four. Okay, so far so good. That's all for my Bloodghast exiled. All right. Fought through some rest in pieces. Now I'm getting a feel for this, how this deck operates under both the good circumstances and the bad circumstances. Channel Fireball has great video content. Also, you can find pre-recorded strategy videos as well as stream VODs, including mine. And you can reach them either via through the ChannelFireball.com main website or by following their YouTube channel. The first league, I went 4-1. I feel like this hand would be really good if I had a sac outlet, but even at face value I can make a 8/8 trample on turn 2, so I guess I'll keep it. I have not played a mirror yet. Well, at least this is the type of matchup where making an 8/8 on turn 2 might just be good enough. And I milled Bloodghast, which I think affords me the luxury of just blocking Goblin Guide here. I think I'm just playing a tapped land, which will return Bloodghast, and then I make Hogaak. Now I found Carrion Feeder, which may give me a chance of comboing off this turn. I get 9 more mills with the supplier. I guess I can't combo off without finding Altar. Though what I could do is find Vengevines. Yeah, I mean, it seems to me the only way I can win this turn is if I mill two Vengevines. So, start by casting this. Found one Vengevine. So I can swing for 15, which will get close to turning off these Sunbaked Canyons or force my opponent to point a burn spell at a creature, which would be great also. Going to sideboarding, seems like I want Wisp Mare and the removal spells. And Dark Blast is not so good against burn. And then something like this. Blood Ghasts don't really do a whole lot. Hi, thanks for the sub. Very much appreciated. I think I can do a Jund stream at some point in July. I said at the start of my stream today that I'm now turning my sights toward Mythic Championship Barcelona, which features Modern Constructed and Modern Horizons Booster Draft. So you're going to see a lot more variety in the formats and decks that I stream over the next month. I'm thinking it'll probably be a pattern somewhat like one day of Modern, one day of Booster Draft, and then one day of playing Arena, maybe Standard or whatever. But yeah, today I'm playing Hogaak, but maybe next week I'll have a Modern day where I try Jund or some other different deck. We'll see where things go. I am a cat. Thank you for the sub also. And Morgan Raven, we're getting a lot of love today. I appreciate it. I was sorry to have to take last week off from streaming, but happy to be back and happy that you all are here. I've not had an opportunity to try the Urza lists just yet. I think I have to bottom this Stitcher's supplier just to try to hit land for the Altar of Dementia. Although, again, I mean, if I just do two Citrus suppliers, I can play Hogaak. It's not that bad. I guess it's probably a good top when you think about it that way. All right. So, one Stitcher supplier will not quite give me enough delve to cast Hogaak. I could play Faithless Looting Stitcher supplier. That takes me to 7. And I think I can just win next turn with Altar of Dementia. So the question is it even worth shocking myself? Am I likely to speed up my clock? My opponent could also just play another Rest in Peace, which would be kind of bad. I think I'm going to play it slow and not shock myself. I milled Bridge from Below, so now I'm just super, super likely to win with the Altar next turn. All right, am I dead? One, two, three, four, five. That brings back the Vengevine. I'm probably not playing this exactly optimally. Like, I probably should sack some of the tapped zombies before the Vengevine triggers happen. I guess I would like to mill a third bridge. Got it. So we have 7 times 2 is 14, plus 12 from the 6 zombies I get is 26, plus 12 is 38. So I need to do one more round of casting Hogaak. Although, yeah. My opponent's got 1 mana plus 2 in their upkeep to kill me. So hypothetically, if they have exactly 3 lightning bolts, I'm dead. Oh, excuse me, only 2 instant speed burn spells. Alright, 3-0. I think I'll finish out this league before I wrap up the stream today. So remember, if you're a fan of Modern and you're going to be around tonight, tune in at 9 p.m. Eastern for the Team Modern Super League. My teammates are Logan Nettles and Gabriel Nassif Yellowhat, and we're taking on the gentleman from Mage Market. Some tough opponents. It's the 1-0 bracket. Prometheus heard a rumor that I'm playing Burn in the Super League. The deck lists are actually already available. You can find them on Hipsters of the Coast or, you know, just by browsing Twitter. But the deck lists are available for tonight. We don't know which player is playing which deck or what order the decks are going to be played, but you can see all of them. I think the Mage Market team actually brought Burn, but we did not. Alright, so this hand is good if I draw a land. If I don't draw a land, basically, I think I'm going to win the turn after I draw a land with this hand. But if we just play and I don't have a land in my top 3 cards or something, then I lose. I think I'm going to throw it back. especially like this is such a good game one deck and I'm behind a mulligan that I think I just have a fine chance of winning even with six or five cards. Though now I'm wishing I had kept my original hand. Man, how many times is this going to happen to me today? It's probably not unreasonable to keep this. And, I mean, if I scry a land to the top, well, I feel like sometimes you go like 6 months without mulliganing to three, and I've done it twice today. Well, I mean, I was thinking about like how much value is there in conceding before I play any cards, but if my opponent's not gonna do anything, I might have a fine chance of winning. Especially if my opponent's on Infect, then this Dark Blast might just go to town. Alright, so you have a 4/4 that costs 7, and you're going to try to Neoform for something cool. Yep. Well, at least I get to see how this works. Well, if my opponent tries to kill me with Lab Maniac, I can beat that with Dark Blast. I mean, I imagine they have, like, Pact of Negation or something, right? Now, my opponent can just pay 7 life with Grizzlebrand to win, but I'll make them do it. Alrighty. So I think I'm bringing in 3 Thought Seizes, and that's it. Don't think. Oh yeah. If I had Lava Axe to kill the Lab Maniac, that would have been sweet. But Wild Cantor, you got it. So I guess I play Alter this turn and then I go for the win on turn 3. Not super likely to get a turn 3, but you never know. Start here. Next, I think I'm supposed to cast Faithless Looting. I found Gravecrawler. Javier, thanks for the sub. I don't know what kind of instance my opponent could have. I'm a little bit worried to discard the Gravecrawler, but sure, I guess it's fine. We're looking for bridges. None yet. Still no bridges. There's one. So now I think it should be smooth sailing. All right, I guess Wild Cantor gets me. Could I have responded by sacrificing the grave crawler? Yes, I could have, and then I would have one zombie instead of the grave crawler, which I guess would be better. My opponent is out of Nourishing Shoals, which means out of Grizzlebrand activations. Alright, so I'm getting lightning stormed to death. Might as well make him have one more land. Alright, so that's going to put me at 3-1. I think I'll try to finish out this league before I wrap up the stream today. In this league, I lost to the Neoform Allosaurus Rider deck, and in the last league, I went 1-1 against Storm. Interesting. I guess that seems good. So I'll play the Neonate, but then not sacrifice it till turn two. Well, if I had known my second card was going to be Bridge from Below, then I would have scryed the first one to the bottom. Man. Well, that was a sound beating. They bring in Leyline of the Void. Alright then, I'll bring in Wispmare. Thank you for the tip. Mill a grave crawler and a Hogaak. Alright, well, that was a decent turn, too. Alright, folks, this will be my last game of the day. Remember, we got Team Modern Super League tonight. I'll be back for probably some Arena, maybe Standard on Arena tomorrow at 11 a.m. All right, well, Cage lines up pretty well against my hand here. Ingot Chewer is great, though. So what I'll do is I will do Faithless Looting, discarding Vengevine and Hogaak probably, and then next turn I can start with Ingot Chewer and then play a second creature, assuming I find, well, the liberal assumption that I'm going to find both a second land and a second creature. But in either case, let's begin with Faithless Looting. Modern Super League is at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. So that's 5.5 hours from now. Wow, Scavenger Grounds. This is quite the hateful deck. I really hope I find a land. Okay. So now we go Ingot Chewer, the Cage. Then grab basic Swamp and play Gravecrawler. Man, I'm so close to getting a Hogaak into play. I will just have to settle for Vengevine, however. Yes. So Looting, Carrion Feeder, Hogaak, which brings back Vengevine. Alright, so my opponent saw the writing on the wall there, the Hogaak and the Vengevine coming back. This deck is pretty sweet, 4-1 in both leagues, including some play errors. But yeah, that was a good first time I've streamed Modern in a while, a good intro to the format.